Okay. So it's the 23rd of February, and this is the last of the series of relationships. And we are going to be talking about loving yourself and about relationships with yourself. And just waiting for Kyle to join. I'm just waiting for Kyle to join. He is going to be literally a few seconds. And once he joins, we're going to start our conversations, because it's the last one that we're doing. And it's all based around relationships. And this one in particular is really, really close to my heart, because it's my whole blog is about loving yourself, being happy with who you are, and sort of enjoying life because of that. Kyle's going to be joining from New York just in a couple of minutes, and it's working now. Hi, Kyle.
Hi.
How are you today?
Good.
Clear, and okay. I can hear you well, and that is really, really good. But
All right, great.
I was just saying that the relationships series that we've been doing, I've absolutely loved every one of them, which we've been talking about friends, we've been talking about family, and this one in particular is really, really close to my heart, because this is sort of what I say to everyone, like, every day.
Yeah.
Loving yourself.
Before yourself.
It's the root. This is the root of how you can expand that love and the happiness, and it's got to start from within yourself. And
absolutely.
I love this topic because I just think it's so important. I think that people don't spend as much time and effort into themselves as they should, really. Do you agree with that?
I don't think so. I agree with you. And I, looking back on my day-to-day practices, I don't spend a lot of time on myself. And it sometimes gets in the way for, even for like 20, almost 23 years, after my brain injury, I still have to practice loving myself. So it's a constant,
practice. Effort into it all the time. And I think for me, I was always a very happy-go-lucky person, but I think as well, since my brain injury, I've become a lot more conscious about making sure that I am happy, that I'm doing things that shows that I really, really care about myself, because that happiness and that love just expands to anyone that is surrounded by you. And I think that is that's what's sort of changed my life. Let's take over.
Yeah.
They change your way of thinking. So when you're so busy in life, and when you're busy with work, or you're busy with, I don't know, studying or whatever, all these things take over what you're supposed to be doing, if you know what I mean. And then have that realization that actually I should be doing those things that are really, really important to me, that help me become who I am, that's when it changes. That's when it completely changes.
Well, and you're kind of forgetting your past. And, because you can't do really anything about your past. That could be a learning point. I can go to my past, draw from, but I've accepted everything in my past, and be able to be in the present, to be able to speak the future,
and enjoying those little things.
Yeah, And then, you know, when I was in, I understand completely where you were, you know, it was a much older point in life. And then when I, you know, I was a lot younger. And, but I think this is for both parties, like, you have to recreate your style. And, you know, whether a clothing change or whether it's like, I was first introduced to the Kyle style when I was with a friend, Austin, in middle school. He was taking an acting class in LA, and his parents and I went up and saw him and performed. And I was walking down Universal Studios, and I was like, "Hey, Larry, you know, can you notice my limp? You know, I'm really, really insecure about my limp." And he goes, "Yeah, I have a little limp, you know, but it's more like a pimp walk." And you know, you have your own, like, style.
Yeah, that's like, it's exciting, though, to recreate your own style. It's exciting.
Yeah, and then I was like, oh, okay. Then, like, I can make something cool of that. Yeah. And that was the feeling that, like, I could change something around, to change the perspective and not always be so insecure. And then, so I started walking around with the pimp walk, you know. And then at, like, recess or, like, lunchtime, you know, when I started to play basketball again, you know, I played with one hand and still with the arm brace and the leg brace. And so I just went out there, and a lot of people, they would get pissed because I would dupe them in my own style. And then someone, I don't remember who it was, the bad one, like, Jonathan Carranza or something like that, where he, where they go, "Oh, the Kyle style." And then I was like, oh my God, yeah, that, like, you know, was a light bulb. And I was like, yeah, that's what I have to do. I have to create my own style.
But you know what, that, I think at the end of the day, there are so many differences that become part of you. And to be able to make that into a positive, I think, is amazing. Because at the end, you know, we're in this life and we want to enjoy each moment. So those, you know, they're not small things, but those things that are hindering us, we need to just embrace them. And I think that's what you've done there, in Kyle's style.
Who you are. You're not going to be back the old self. Even if you recover, you know, fully percent, you know, 100%.
Yeah.
And, you know, and
don't try and be someone else. It's just not good. It's actually, you know, it's very hard work trying to be someone else. Just, it's more hard
just
work.
Be you, because that's all you can ever be. And nowadays, the world is more authentic more than anything else. And I hate to say this about social media is terrible, but it's actually really, really positive, because it's bringing out positive, authentic side of people. Because no one likes all the, you know, fancy pictures where, you know, they're, you know, holding in, you know, like, their, you know, pose in the dentist office and saying, "Hey, oh my God." You know, I was like, well, you got a professional, like, photographer to, for you to pose at the the dentist's office. Come on.
Some of that still, but the realistic versions of using social media and showing the real life things. Mm-hmm. What I put on, because like I said, my blog on my Instagram is mainly about loving yourself and making sure that you are happy within yourself and doing things that make you happy. And one of the things that I do put on is sometimes when I'm actually a little bit tired or I'm a little bit stressed or whatever, I will put on a sad face onto my social media. So it's because you can't be happy all the time, ever all the time. That's not real. That's not real life. When I had my subarachnoid hemorrhage, one of the things that was really, really, that really affected me was my physical appearance. And so I lost a lot of my hair. And as you can see, like, I have like a lot of hair now, but at the time, going from long hair to being shaved all on one side and, you know, underneath and being cut everywhere and having like bald patches in places, you can imagine how it was really, really damaging for my sort of physical appearance, because I do take pride in how I look. I do take pride in the way I present myself. I was always, you know, going to meetings and things like that. So it was so difficult for me. It was very, very, very emotionally draining to have that physical change. And I decided that I wasn't going to let it sort of beat me. And I then started to wear, like, you know, these clip-on things in my hair. I called someone up and I asked them to help me. And that's the biggest thing, to ask someone to help you. And I got these things put in my hair that, because I couldn't put anything weaved into my hair. It was so sore with all the scars and everything. I got these things clipped into my hair because I couldn't actually go out anywhere. I was too scared to see people. And that then gave me the confidence to be able to love myself again. And that was the physical, one of the physical aspects that that I changed. But I could only do that because I had the courage to be able to say, hey, I'm not going to let this eat me. I'm going to do something about it. And I went out, I found someone. And when they did it, I felt a bit better. The emotional side. So because I didn't recognize who I was after my brain injury, I felt very, very alone. I didn't understand what was going on. And it was when I decided to start going to the Priory, which is like a medical place here where you can get therapy and everything. And it was only then that I started to really understand what I was going through. And that was the turning point of me starting to love myself more, because I couldn't even look at myself in the mirror. I just didn't want to see that. I didn't know who that person was that I was seeing in the mirror. And that is a big thing. I just couldn't. It was really, really hard. Another physical thing that...
How do you look in the mirror now?
I love looking in the mirror now. But I still think I look different, okay? So I still think that I'm looking at a different person to who I was before, but I've accepted that person and I've accepted who I am. I think those things, they never actually went away. They just became more accepting. And I think that was the thing for me. There was one other thing as well. So because I was in hospital for nearly 2 months, my posture and my sort of physical being was completely different. So like my head was protruded forward and my shoulders were hunched and my whole body, you know, it was different. So again, it was difficult for me to meet people and talk to people and socialize. So I started to get physiotherapy done to be able to change my posture. And the thing is, because I got that physiotherapy done, it then helped me become more confident again and be able to go out again and be myself again. So I think it's, those things were just, it was really, really hard. But but those things don't just take a day to fix or a few hours to fix. They took weeks and months, you know?
Years.
Recovery is an ongoing process. It's still ongoing. Okay.
And then, what about music?
Maybe I should just talk.
I know, maybe you should.
I'm only joking. when we post this, we're going to have to put some subtitles on there.
Yeah. distortion on your end. I hear the young lady fine.
Oh, someone's called me young. That's so nice. Thank you.
I think this is all Tina. Just one more, like, really important thing, you know, like, you know, I experienced a pediatric stroke network back in the day, like 1999, and that helped shut down, but I was able to meet with and be really good friends with Valerie, and community is huge. And that won't, I'm putting this out there, okay?
Yeah.
Being a part of the community will help you love yourself, but that is not the end goal.
Yeah.
It was amazing. Valerie and I connected on such a personal level. And nothing can take that away.
Yeah.
But there were times when I still looked back and I still went and did, you know, just hated myself because I didn't go, I couldn't recover physically. And I didn't love me and I didn't, you know, yada yada. So, again, the community is so, so important, and to wrap yourself, but you have to also find your own style within that community, and there's proof that when you hear of other people doing something triumphant, that registers and gives you access to create your own possibility. And when you hear that, you say, oh my God, then I can do this. And but so...
You know, when you were saying about community, that's so important because basically when I came out of hospital, there was like literally no community.
Yeah.
And I don't know if in America, I don't know if people are a little bit more open compared to, like, I feel like people are a little bit more sort of conservative here. So they don't like to talk about things in a very open way, sort of compared to, say, your community. So I just found, I wish that I did have a community because now, I'm like part of a few different groups. And if anyone's listening and anyone wants to be sort of in a community state to be able to get some help, you know, there's a few, the Health and Block, there's the Hemorrhage group on Facebook, there's, you know, there's quite a few different ones. And you are 100% right, Kyle. The community that is surrounding what the same situation that you are going through really, really, really helps with that confidence building, with understanding, with making sure that you can go back to loving who you are and making sure you are investing in you.
And that you feel safe creating a new life. Because you're not going to get that old side back. Like my coach said when I had my stroke of genius, Kyle, the old Kyle is dead. It's the new Kyle, and how he has to go on an adventure to see who he is.
Yeah. And you know, that adventure of reinventing yourself can be quite exciting. It can be you can actually rediscover a lot of things that you used to like doing or that you like doing now. And you can really, really focus on having a life that's, you know, all about yourself and all about what you love. And I think that's really special. I think that's really, really, you know, a great thing that can happen. It's like you've been given a chance. That's
it. It is. And several years ago, I said, I've never played a piano. I'm going to take the piano. But I mean, I've been one hand. I don't care. And I just did.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, let's go skydiving. And I did it.
Yeah, but I don't remember to everyone. Just because of the insurance of making it safe. But yeah, it's still an amazing thing to do.
Oh, but Kyle, that's your thing.
But that's amazing. That's amazing that you... So you play the piano now?
I don't play the piano, but I tried it this time.
At least you tried it. That's a great thing. But I used to love, when I was younger, when I was like 16, 17, I used to love painting. And when I got married, had my kids, just didn't have time to do any of that. And now I spend probably every week, but maybe an hour and a half, and I sit and draw and paint. It is the most wonderful experience and time that I spend doing every week. I look forward to it so much that it makes me feel so happy. Like I sit there and it's actually very therapeutic also. So if you have got issues with anxiety or anything, then, you know, doing painting or coloring, it's really, really therapeutic. And I actually do that now. And I just think I wasted 20 odd years not doing any of that. And I don't know why.
Gal, it just depends. And then just like walk around the park. I do a lot of my activities alone. I have a lot of friends that I go out with. But I do a lot of my activities alone because that's my choice. And I take a walk in the park, in Central Park, and enjoy the nature. And it's very gratifying only have time with
nature's
you.
Been
I mean, like you said, you go on walks with the dog.
Yeah, so sorry to cut you off, but nature has been my best friend. It has been the most exhilarating thing. And again, like even today, I was so tired today because I had like so much to do over the weekend, and I still made time to strap my dog up. Me and my husband went for a walk outside, and it was beautiful, beautiful. And I just think that it's, like you said before, taking the time, you have to take time to work. You have to take time to drop your kids off. You have to take time to eat. So why not take time on yourself?
Yeah.
It's a must. And if you do that, it can change everything. Really investing in yourself is something that if you do it, it can help everything else around you. So reinvesting in yourself and putting that love back into yourself can help work. It can help you with sleep. It can help you with anxiety. It can help you with, you know, if it's something like doing a walk, it can help you with your physical abilities or your health. All of these things is because you are spending time and investing in yourself. It has to happen. And there is so many people that just don't do it. They just spend their time trying to juggle everything else and not really focusing on themselves. Mm-hmm. I just think it's a little sad.
It's just like a lot of people tend to gravitate to one restaurant or one bar. And you know, there's so many options in New York City. So I was like, well, it's the first year, I'm going to all of them.
The thing that I did was trying to venture out and traveling more. I know that, you know, travel comes with a cost, but still, I wanted to be able to explore places and see places. And you don't have to go to expensive places, but it's just seeing more culture. And I love things like that. It inspires me, you know, with everything that I do. And I think that was one of the things that I wanted to do more. And the other thing was as well, because me loving myself and me spending time doing the things that I love, one of them is my family. Mm-hmm. So it's my kids and my husband and my little dog. And basically, I wanted to be able to, you know, spend more time with them. So I know we spoke about this last time, you know, with friends and everything. So I did pull back a little bit. But that's not because I didn't want to spend more time with my friends. It's because I wanted to use my time a little bit more efficiently and doing things that I enjoyed, which was spending time with my family. So I started to do more of that as well. So that just changed my sort of social life as well. And like you said, that you enjoy doing some of your activities on your own. I'm like quite comfortable with that as well. So when I'm doing my painting, sometimes my son joins me, which is quite nice, but he gets bored after 5 minutes. So he then leaves the room and I'm still carrying on. But yeah, I quite enjoy it. And I think if you're comfortable in doing those things that you enjoy, that you can, whether it's by yourself or with your family or whoever, it's quite nice. It's quite nice to be able to do that and have the confidence to do it.
It never goes back to its original shape. And it's said someone else by the same old, it's an old quote. But, you know, once your mind is stretched, it never goes back to the original shape. And that's true in trying to find something to be able to love yourself. You learn something new. Your mind is stretched. Yeah. And so, because I mean, we'll be learning all our lives.
Yeah.
You know, there's going to be new and innovative ways to do everything. So, you know, so it's a constant learning and discovery. And when you can grasp that and apply that to your brain, it really becomes like, wow.
And I think as well, because everyone's different,
mm-hmm.
everyone has a different, I would say, capacity of learning and a different stretched version. Like, some people might have a smaller stretch than others. Other people might have a larger stretch. But I think as well, it's also what suits you.
Right.
It's like the whole thing about social media, TV, YouTube, all of these different things. So I'm having a conversation with my family about, I don't know, the president. And
okay.
States, okay. So I wasn't sure if my son actually knew what was going on. And he sort of joined the conversation. And I was just like, how do you actually know? Because I've never seen you watch the news. I don't know how you have that information. And he said, I saw it on YouTube. And I was just like, oh my God. And I think it's the whole thing about people getting information from so many different areas. It's the same with the brain as well. Like,
yes, yes, we did. Sorry.
You've got to be able to channel in what is good for you and what suits you. So
right.
That information. I know someone's put that message on. So I had a subarachnoid hemorrhage in 2015, and that was in March, which was nearly 5 years ago. And Kyle, do you want to say what you had?
Yeah, I had 1997, 2 years ago, and when I was 11. So
I think, you know, when people are joining, like, they might not know sort of what's happened to us. But I going back to the conversation about yeah, that brain being stretched and absorbing the information, it's what suits you. Because there's so many things you can learn, there's so many things that can really, really help, but it's what you enjoy, and you that channel to be able to absorb that information, because there's just so much out there, and it can be amazing. It can be really, really amazing once you're at that point. But it takes time. This all takes time.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's why it's just go on the journey.
Yeah. I think for me, it's only happened in the last maybe couple of years. I think before that, I was still struggling with discovering myself, knowing what I was, understanding what was going on. So I think it's but you know, when it does happen, when that turning point does happen, it can change the way you think about things. I feel that I'm happier now than what I was before my brain injury. I feel I'm happier now. Someone's put on, can you believe that the brain can regenerate?
Yeah, I do. It's neuroplasticity. And it's amazing how brain reworks and recircuits. You know, but you have to do work to do it. And because if you just lie in bed, doesn't do anything, or if you do the same thing in repetition, you know, it's all about finding your routine.
It's like a muscle, isn't it? The brain. Where if you go to the gym and you are trying to, say, get fitter or losing weight or whichever way it is, or getting stronger, the brain is like a similar part of the body that also needs that training. It also needs help in sort of rediscovering itself. And it is a muscle, isn't it? I think it's a muscle.
Yeah.
It needs help and it needs training and it needs work. Still very, very, very early on. I said that it takes such a long time to be able to get to, I feel, the point that I'm at. It's taken me a long time. But I think you can't expect the changes to happen straight away. But I think with perseverance and, you know, just thinking about things and just seeing what's good for you, I think that always helps. But, you know, we're talking about making sure that you love yourself.
Yeah.
I think that's the first thing to start with. And I think making sure that you take that time out to be able to look after who you are and look after what you want to be and who you want to be. You know, all of these things, I think, are the fundamental start of becoming a better person and going on that recovery journey and being better.
You know, Chris, I need steps one, that we shouldn't get mad at ourselves. It goes along with loving yourself. But three steps are own it, fuck it, and create your own story of triumph. Because no one wants to listen to a poo-poo story. And so how to...
You just said, I'm just going to repeat it because someone can't hear it clearly. So what you're saying is make sure that you own it. Make sure that you, I don't want to say the word because I don't swear, but anyway, it, because it's really important that if you can't do something, don't keep try doing it. Just do something else or just move on to something else. Mm-hmm. And it's just, really, really important that you can't focus your whole time trying to fix something that can't be fixed.
Yeah.
You have to focus your time on the things that are working and the things that are doing better and the things that you can improve on. And I think that's really, really, really important. That could be a physical thing. That could be an emotional thing. It could be anything. Mm-hmm. And I just think that's really, really important.
Chris, I just watched it too, and on Netflix, and I always said, you know, like it's like a rebirth, it's like my second birthday, and so I got two birthdays, and so that's kind of cool. And
on your second birthday,
what?
You blow out candles on your second birthday?
No, I go out hard. Like
I have a cake, and I do.
That's awesome. I have a good time. Yeah. And I go out to the beach for the day for the weekend. So because I had it at the beach. And so I go out and we have a great, great time celebrating it. So, and it's right down in the middle of the sun. So it's perfect time.
Yeah, the rebirth thing is so important, and making sure that you celebrate that time, I think, as well, is really important, because you're celebrating the new you and you're celebrating the change that you've accepted, really. So the rebirth thing is amazing. I always have a cake And I always have candles, and I make sure that when it's that anniversary, that I get a chance to be able to sort of celebrate this new life that I've got and celebrate who I am. You know, the not very nice thing, which my daughter has to sort of experience, that my hemorrhage happened the day before her birthday.
Mm.
Okay. So every time it's her birthday, she gets really, really upset because it happened that timing. So now, the day before, I blow candles on a cake, and then the day after, she blows candles on a cake. But I just said to her that don't think that it's a bad timing for your birthday. Always think this is a good thing because your mum's actually here and your mum's actually with you. Because she always thinks it's bad luck. It's, you know, it happened. Da, 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 da. So I think, yeah, what you said, again, I'm just repeating what you're saying so that people can hear it properly. But
you can say that.
The rebirth thing is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I celebrate that rebirth.
Yeah.
You go out to a party because you do it on the beach and I do it at home with a little cake. I think it's amazing to do that. And celebrate that you're here. Celebrate that you're in this world. Celebrate that you're in this life. And
life. Like, you live.
Yeah.
I mean, you could have been gone, and you not having the opportunity to enjoy everything. Your body is not who you are.
It's a soul.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's I think a few people are saying, someone's saying that they're celebrating their 3 year. And it was
the fifth year.
It was a third year for someone.
Third year.
And Chris has said it was February.
And Chris, we are doing the show again. So thank you. Chibita, you were saying that this show must go on. And we only have 3 minutes. It's going to come out all distorted.
It's fine. I'll make it up with dance movements.
Okay, ready? Are you ready?
We're putting a bit just in
and I didn't want to write it wrong, because I didn't want anyone thinking I still care or don't, but you still hit my phone. Baby, I've been moving on.
So,
I think it should be something I don't want.
As we conclude everything, I can really be in service to that.
But we'll be putting these on your IGTV on Share Your Stroke of Genius, and we'll also be putting it on YouTube eventually. And also, I'm just going to hold this up again, which is my book, Room 23, Surviving a Brain Hemorrhage. So I've written a lot of detail in there about relationships with family, friends, and about myself. So I think we should, encourage everyone to go on to Share Your Stroke of Genius. Make sure that you have a look at our IGTV videos. See some of the previous ones that we've done, because I'm hoping that they're helpful.
Yeah.